Chapter 38 of the Bible refers of the genesis of the ancestor of Jesus, in the moment in which is formed the God's people. Therefore, when we desire to take information about the genesis of God, this chapter 38 of the Genesis is the necessary and the sufficient place of the sacred scripture. But it refers not only to a child born, but a pair of twins. And it happens a strange, very strange thing. Who was the first of the two wanted put in evidence is to be the first. He put out his hand, and the woman who was with the mother put a red thread around his hand, saying, "This one came out first." The point 29 of Genesis 38 says, "But then he, that was the first, took his hand back again, and his brother came first to birth." Well, in this strange, very, very strange way to happen, of a twin that shows is to be the first and afterwards makes a way to be born by second, is the clear oracle of the return of Jesus in his father, a matter that is named parousia of Jesus. Genesis 38. At that time, Judah left his brothers and stayed with an Adullamite man named Hira. There Judah saw the daughter of a Canaanite man named Shua. Judah acquired her as a wife and had marital relation with her. She became pregnant and had a son. Judah named him Er. She became pregnant again and had another son whom she named Onan. Then she had yet another son whom she named Shelah. She gave birth to him in Kezib. Judah acquired a wife for Er, his firstborn. Her name was Tamar. But Er, Judah's firstborn, was evil in the Lord's sight, so the Lord killed him. Then Judah said to Onan, "Have sexual relation with your brother's wife, and fulfill the duty of a brother-in-law to Er, so that you may raise up a descendant for your brother." But Onan knew that the child would not be considered his. So, whenever he had sexual relation with his brother's wife, he withdrew prematurely, so as not to give his brother a descendant. What he did was evil in the Lord's sight, so the Lord killed him too. Then Judah said to his daughter-in-law Tamar, "Live as a widow in your father's house until Shelah, my son, grows up." For he thought, I don't want him to die like his brothers. So Tamar went and lived in her father's house. After some time, Judah's wife, the daughter of Shua, died. After Judah was consoled, he left for Timnah to visit his sheep shearers, along with his friend Hira the Adullamite. Tamar was told, "Look, your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep." So she removed her widow clothes and covered her with a veil. She wrapped herself and sat at entrance to Timnah, to Enaim, which is on the way to Timnah. She did this because she saw that she had not been given to Selah as a wife, even thought he had now grown up. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute because she had covered her face. He turned aside to her along the road and said, "Come on, I want to have sex with you." He did not realize it was his daughter-in-law. She asked, "What will you give me in exchange for having sex with you?" He replied, "I'll send you a young goat from the flock." She asked, "Will you give me a pledge until you send it?" He said, "What pledge should I give you?" She replied, "Your seal, your cord, and the staff that's in your hand." So he gave them to her and had sex with her. She became pregnant by him. She left immediately, removed her veil, and put on her widow's clothes. Then Judah had his friend Hirah the Adullamite take a young goat to get back from the woman the item he had given in pledge. But Hirah could not find her. He asked the men who were there, "Where is the cult prostitute who was at Enaim by the road?" But they replied, "There has been no cult prostitute here." So he returned to Judah and said, "I could not find her. Moreover, the men of the place said there has been no cult prostitute here." Judah said, "Let her keep the things for herself. Otherwise, we will appear to be dishonest. I did in this end this young goat, but you could not find her." After 3 months, Judah was told, "Your daughter-in-law Tamar has turned to prostitution, and as a result, she has become pregnant." Judah said, "Bring her out and let her be burned." While they were bringing her out, she sent word to her father-in-law, "I am pregnant by the man to whom this belongs." Then she said, "Identify the one to whom the seal, cord, and the staff belong." Judah recognized them and said, "She is more upright than I am, because I would not give her to Sheila, my son. He did not have a sexual relation with her again. When it was time for her to give birth, there were twins in her womb. While she was giving birth, one child put out his hand and the midwife took a scarlet thread and tied it on his hand, saying, "This one came out first." But then he drew back his hand, and his brother came out before him. She said, "How you have broken out of the womb?" So he was named Perez. Afterward, his brother came out, the one who had the scarlet thread on his hand, and he was named Zerah. The two twins are the father and the son. The father that is before the son, and that is really the first. The sacred Bible must write that the father is the first, but is twin of his son, being both born from a single cell, a single egg, which was afterward divided into two, as happens in every twin. This is really of greatest importance. In fact, the Genesis that is described in Genesis 58 is referred to one only egg, one only maternal egg that was fertilized by one only embryo. This egg, one alone, was divided in two, becoming a pair of the same development program. Its development leads to two that are one only program. This is very, very, very important for the faith in Jesus Christ, that affirm that father and son are the same thing, are the same egg that is divided into development programs, that are the same. But afterward, becoming two different twins, every single body must necessarily come into the world before of another. If we know that the son is born before of the father, who seems not yet born the father, the twin that was the ancestor of Jesus must be, between the two, the child that was born first, also being the second, and who was named Perez, as it is written at the end of the point 29 of the Genesis 58. And it is true one,
Because in the genealogy of Jesus, written by Saint Matthews, the ancestor of Jesus was indicated exactly as Peretz. Now, I ask you again, why the ancestor of Jesus was the second twin? You answer me, it happened in this way because of the birthing of Jesus before of that of the Father. That is not yet happened. The Father was the first, but was made in a way that the Son was being born before of him. Now, I ask you, but why? It is clear that every father is born before of his son. You can answer me only that God wanted in this way. And it is an answer. I'll tell you and explain this oracle. Through works and action of this birth is narrated all the planned arrival in the world as of the Son, as of the Father. And the Father in name, year, month, and day of birth. First, it is say that there is a fourth son of Jacob, called Judas, who has three sons. The eldest was called Er married Tamar, but died. So Tamar is married to the second son of Judah, to give an heir, but also the second dies. Judah seeks the excuse that the third child is too young and send Tamar to her father, promising the wedding in the future. Judas did not keep his promise because he understood that his sons did not have to give him an heir. Why? Because God had already killed two of his three sons, and Judah had learned the lesson. But the lesson was understood also by Tamar, who decided that only Judas, he only was who had to work to obtain his progeny. So Tamar held out a trap to Judas and did a way to become pregnant by Judas himself. Now I ask you again, why? Why God did not want that one of the sons of Judah transform him in a grandfather? What is the reason? There are big. It's a necessary reason. The reason is that what happened to Tamar had to happen to the Holy Mary, the mother of Jesus. Tamar can be, in fact, the anagram of Marta, where the difference between Tamar and Martha is only the cross T at the place of the eye of the Jesus. Mary also would not have had a child by her husband, but from the Father of all fathers in the world. It was necessary to express the prophetic message of Jesus' birth, a child born to a mother made fruitful by the true Father of all the fathers and of all the sons in the world. In fact, Genesis 38 deals with Jesus himself, who will be born in the 38th generation since Judah is real father. It clearly appears in the genealogy of Jesus as described by St. Matthew. From Judas, Jesus is the Genesis number 38, which is described in Genesis 38 of the Bible. But if the mother Tamar is the anagram of Mary, her dead husband, to whom she absolutely had to give an heir, was her, the anagram of Re, which is in Italian a word that means a king. Not only, since the vowels in the Hebrew language did not exist, R was only the consonant R and could allude to the first letter of the name of the father. One dead, non-existent, that would have been replaced by his father alive, where only one parent living really, and is God. In few words, Mr. R is a poor character that has not his own personal life. He is as a puppet that represents the true living father who animates him, or a father who animates it as a thing and not as a man, since R is not a man but a poor figurative thing of a man in which the father is who truly is living. All this is contained in the story said in Genesis 38. R is really a figurative thing, a poor character in which, since it is a thing and not a man, is God, Godfather, who exists really, having assumed its place as husband, as of Tamar, as of Mary, the mother of Jesus. So, we have the first important revelation. Godfather will be in a puppet whose first letter of its name is A. Mr. A. Who is Mr. A? Since Genesis 38 is described the birth not only of the Son, but also of his father, as the two transformation of one only egg that becomes two twins, we have seen about Jesus that Genesis 58 is the oracle of the Genesis 58 begun by Judas, the true living father. Therefore, Genesis 58 must be significant also for the Genesis of the father, whose name begins by R. It cannot be the 58th generation in the order of the generations, because the 58th generation is referred to Jesus. Therefore, Genesis 58 can mean a birth in a year, the year 58. The living father may have been born in the 58 and be named R, etc. Now, if the Genesis 58 refers to the father who is living in something named R, this number 58 for him as the meaning of the birth about something is referred to something that is like a year, the year 38, the Genesis of the year 38. So the firstborn regarding the year 38 can be, or the first as day, or the first of a month, January, as day, the first of every month, of month only the first month, January. But Jesus was born in the 15 days, and so this first cannot be the day. Perhaps it can be the first month, January. And it is possible, because the first month is first becoming in this direction, and the December is the first becoming in this other direction. We are describing of a first that is transformed in a second, and a January that is the first that is transformed in the last is a January transformed in December. First, in both directions. So, it can be the December 25. Now, if you protest that the December 25 has been a choice arbitrary one of the church, because the Jesus birth took the place of the celebration of God Saturn in Rome, the father of Zeus. Oh, is not this exactly what is described in Genesis 58 of the Son that takes the place of the Father? Well, having confirmed that our mysterious Mr. R must be born in January of 38, and that the first month, January, had to be substituted by the last month of the year, December, the question is, and the day. Now, like God Saturn, also his son, not Jesus, but Jesus, had the same December 25 as the common celebration. So the day must be the same 25, but of January 38 for the father. Until now, we have January 25, 38, and the letter L as the beginning of the name in which the living God should be incarnated. We do not know only the century and the remaining part of the name after the first letter, that is a R. But a thing till now we have not yet considered, that hand that the child has put out of the sex of his mother. What is the means? Is the five? Is it a word? If is it the number is the five, but if is it the word, in what language? Well, I do this consideration, not only, a lot of consideration. God Saturn went in Italy when Zeus took his kingdom over all the gods. Also the Church of the Son of God, that has taken the place of Godfather, is in Rome, which begins with the same R, being the Roman Catholic Apostolic Church. The Roman Catholic Apostolic Church. Judas, the true father of R, afterward, is a son of Leah, is the last son, the fourth. Well, Jesus made miracles saying Talita Kumi, two words, one before of the other. If we do as in this strange build and overturn the order between Talita Kumi, we have Cum Italita, that is Cum Italia T. It's Latin. Cum means with the cross in Italy, and is named the Italia. Jesus made miracles saying the name of the Italia, but referring to Leah, the mother, Italia is Ita Leah, where Ita is Latin, and in Latin it means went, where Leah is went. So Italia refers where the mother of Judas is went, where Leah is went, is Ita is went in Italia, in Italy, with the father, with Saturn, father of his son. Oh, not Zeus. In our case, is the son, Jesus, that take the place of Godfather and that is pride as a god. Jesus has place, has took the place of his father in the Christianity. It is a lot of also in the names of the two twins, we are that one is named Phares, the ancestor of Jesus. The other is named Zerach. In the first, there is Ar. But it is overturned. The second is R.A. in Zerach. And so we have also the sign of the first letter of the surname. If the name is R, the surname is A. Since Ra is the god of the Egypt by which the son was taken, as it is written. Well, if by all this consideration the language that we must use is the Italian, the hand must be named mano. And we have this situation. The father is R. The sex of the mother is a big O, from which the mano is went out. R, O, mano, is Romano. And so, we have also a reason for the Roman Catholic Apostolic Church. If Romano is just the name of Godfather, is the Church of Godfather, is if it is the Roman Church. Well, in this situation we have A, the surname, Romano, the name, born in January 25, in the year 58. And the five can be Romano having five names by a total of those 42 ciphers that are said in the Kabbalah of the Jews for the sacred name of God. Well, I have said a lot, but now, my dears, my name is Romano Antonio Anna Paolo Torquato, and they are five. When in Genesis 38 appears this end, appears as Romano having five names. My surname begins with the A of Amodeo, and the ciphers of this my name contains 56 letters at work, and 6 are of not work of the Sabbath of the divine rest. The total between 56 plus 7, the space between the 5 names, are for exactly the 42 letters, no letters, ciphers of the sacred name of God. I also am born in Genesis, in January, where Genesis is also January of the 38 in the day 25. So Genesis is the generation, the gennaio, gen is gennaio, in English is January, but in Italian January is written as gennaio, the same gen of Genesis 38. So in Genesis 38 there is the first January and 38 in the same name of the first book of the Genesis. Am I this mysterious Mr. that is the oracle of the re equal to the king? Am I? Is something in Genesis 38 that can show also the surname Amodeo? Well, the mother name is Tamar, in which there is T, the cross, Hem, I am, the to be, ma it is the beginning of Amodeo. Hem is I am, is God, eh? The cross of God, T, M, R, Amodeo Romano. Tamar is the cross of Amodeo, Amodeo Romano. And the Kabbalah of Tamar that is obtained in summing the place that the single letter have in the Italian alphabet, the Kabbalah of Tamar is 18 plus 1 plus 11 plus 1 plus 16 equal to 47, and 47 is also the Kabbalah of the surname Amodeo, that is made by 1 plus 11 plus 13 plus 4 plus 5 plus 13. Afterward, in Italian, Tamar means Tamar, that is loving you, while Amodeo means I am zero with God, because Deo is Latin and means cum Deo, the ablative of Deus. Amodeo means I am zero cum God, with God. And it is exactly the secret meaning of the R that is dead in Genesis 38, is a zero. that has to be substituted by his father to is able to be able to have a generation. And so is Amodeo. I am zero, but with God. Er, with his father, is the father of Jesus. I am sure that Genesis 38 is the true oracle of my birth. Godfather is the cross of a puppet. I am a puppet. I am a zero. I am a thing. Not a man, a thing. A poor character of a story. I have also said that I am also the best in the apocalypse. And I have explained why. The best in apocalypse is 666. And Romano is 66, where 6 in Italian means you are. So 666 is you are 66, you are Romano. And Romano is the father who arrives in the world and enters in his enemy as Neo in the movie named Matrix does to win his enemy. In the first film, movie, in the first movie is Neo that enters in the body of his enemy and makes that it explodes. In the third movie of Matrix, Neo is entered by his enemy and the enemy entered in God is winned because the darkness cannot win the light. When darkness and the light are mixed together, is the light the winner. And this is the expression. Explanation by which I am not only the best but also the father that had to arrive in the world and that is described exactly by the Genesis 38, which is the narration of the birth of Jesus. It's not only Jesus to be birth, it's a couple of two twins that are part of the same development program. And this is all.